Hello everyone, welcome to HIV 2020 online. This is the session on the dollars and cents of effective grant making. So we have a few pre-announcements to make, so I will go through those now. Please choose the audio channel for the language of your choice by selecting interpretation and then the language. It helps to mute original audio to only hear the interpreter. We have some guidelines for participation. We want to remind you that HIV 2020 online sessions offer a safe and neutral space for sharing of knowledge, experience, skills, and opinions in a mutually respectful manner. HIV 2020 online operates on a zero tolerance policy for any kind of bullying, harassment, abusive use of language, aggressive opinion, expression of opinions, or any such undesirable behaviors. This includes any activity during the Zoom session or on HIV 2020 online social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, that may cause distress to panelists, speakers, translators, or participants. Session participants who engage in such actions will be immediately removed from the session with no prior notice. I'd also like to let you know that this session is being recorded and it's being live streamed on the HIV online Facebook page. After the session, the recording will be made available on the HIV 2020 online website and social media platforms. For the panelists and speakers, we must need to remind ourselves to speak slowly and clearly for the interpreters. All the attendees, you don't have the microphone or video functions enabled. So to participate, which we welcome, we ask you to ask questions through the Q&A function or provide comments by raising your hand through the raise hand button. You may, if chosen by my co-moderator, Sarah Hamilton, be invited to speak if you have a comment that we'd like to raise in. Please use the question and answer option to raise questions and keep the chat option for comments and general commentary. We do apologize in advance that if we have a large number of people participating, not everyone who asks a question will be able to have it answered or be able to speak, but we really welcome participation and we're very excited about this session. So just to talk about the session, we had envisaged this as an opportunity for a dialogue between grant makers and key population led community organizations. And we envisaged it as a way of opening up the discussion about how to improve the participation and engagement of key population led community organizations. And also wanting to recognize that when we think about HIV funding these days, that actually it's addressing a whole load of very intersectional issues. I think the days of HIV specific funding are long over, and we take on much wider issues, including those around universal health coverage. We want to engage that meaningful involvement of key population-led organizations, and we want to enable a real, genuine, human-to-human dialogue between funders and key population-led community organizations. You can see from the screen what a fantastic panel and discussants we have. I'll introduce people as they come along. I have to admit, I'm not gonna go through everybody's CV in my introduction. If you want to find out more about them, they'll most likely be on LinkedIn. And we do also, we've had long conversations about this session as we were planning it, and we know that this is not a place for us to be asking for funding. This is not a solicitation space. So just be aware of that. It's about getting that dialogue going and talking to each other about all the challenges we face on both sides of the table. Fundamentally, we know that there's more that unites us in this response than there is that sets us apart. And that's the basic fundamental philosophy of this conversation. So I'm going to move on now to invite some framing statements, comments from our co-sponsors and also who are our discussants. I'm going to start with John Barnes, who's the Executive Director of Funders Concerned About AIDS. Thanks, John. Do go ahead.
Thank you, Kate, and thanks to all of our panelists and discussants and to everyone who's joining from all over the world. We're really excited to have this platform to bring funders and community members together. Funders Concerned About AIDS is a global network of funders who identify HIV as a priority for their grant making. And we exist to educate and inform those funders about best practices. We also produce a report each year analyzing global philanthropic activity supporting HIV and AIDS. And we really try to highlight the gaps. We also do periodic reports on other issues. One such report is our last mile funding report. And that was an effort to interview representatives of key population organizations around the world to help identify best practices in grant making. And you can find that report on our website. And we'll probably be referencing it throughout the session. But what we'd like to do today, I think we had a couple of dozen interviews, but today's really an opportunity to continue those dialogues and to cast the net much wider. In addition to working with HIV identified grant makers, we work within broader philanthropy to try and shed some light at the intersections of HIV and other critical issues such as human rights, LGBT rights, sex worker rights, health access, and that sort of thing. And so FCAA would like to be an ambassador between the HIV community and broader philanthropy to help continue to widen the circle of funders who are engaged in HIV work. And we're looking forward to taking some of what we learned from today's conversations back to that broader philanthropic audience that we interact with. And with that, I'm going to turn it back to Kate to introduce our next speaker.
Thanks very much, John. That's great. And I do recommend that last mile funding report. It's got some really good recommendations in it. So now I'm handing over to Shaun, who's director of Shaun Mellors, who's director of programs and technical at Positive Action ViiV Healthcare.
Thank you, Kate, and thank you, John. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all the panelists and participants from around the world. Positive Action is the community granting mechanism of ViiV Healthcare and was actually started in 1993 under Burroughs' welcome as probably the first pharmaceutical community-based funding program. In December, we launched our new Positive Action strategy, which focuses on achieving healthy communities in a world free of AIDS. We work with and invest in what we refer to as priority populations, which for us are children, adolescents and young people, in particular adolescent girls and young women, gay men and other men who have sex with men, sex workers, transgender people and people who use drugs. As a donor, we recognize and believe in the principle of nothing for us without us, and we place people living with HIV and those affected by HIV at the center of everything that we do. We are, at the end of the day, an HIV-focused funder, and therefore we look at our funding priorities and decisions through the lens of HIV to ensure that no person living with HIV is left behind. Without a doubt, COVID has created a different reality, and in many ways, COVID is the torch that highlights deep rooted discrimination, blame, prejudice, isolation, and stigma that remain in our society. Many donors, including ourselves, have created their own COVID emergency response fund. But I think it is critical that as donors, we get together to figure out how we come together to meet the increasing needs of communities on the ground. Of course, each donor wants to do the right thing and be seen to be doing the right thing. But does it really require each donor to have their own COVID fund? We know that many communities, and particularly KP-led organizations, are struggling for resources, exacerbated by COVID, no doubt. So how do we as the donors provide value add in how we fund and when we fund? Ironically, COVID has highlighted that money is out there. The world galvanized to raise resources for the COVID emergency response. So we know that the money is out there. It just takes political will to find it and to make it available. In addition, I think both HIV and most recently COVID has enabled and in some cases forced communities to innovate. Differentiated service delivery models, creative program implementation, strategies to increase access to services and support. And we as donors, again, need to be creative as to how we deal with and resource community-based innovation. Not from our silos or ivory towers, but how do we work together as donors to really engage and iterate with grantees to create a pipeline of innovation. And so I look forward to speaking to some of the panelists about these issues. As Positive Action and ViiV Healthcare, we are very pleased and honored to be working with funders concerned about AIDS and the amazing panelists in bringing this dialogue together, because it is just that. We need to find more spaces to have constructive dialogue in how we can be more responsive and accountable to the communities that we serve. Thank you, Kate.
Thanks very much, Shaun. There's a lot to think about in what both you and John have said. And I totally agree with that view of COVID being like a light that is shining to show us the inequities. I've always said that about HIV as well, and COVID is showing us that again. So here's how the session is going to run. We have three videos to show you, and we've also got three questions that are going to be asked by our discussants of our panelists. So we're going to allow about 20 minutes each for a video and then a question. And that'll give us time at the end for some question and answers from you, the audience, the participants. So we'll begin now with a video from Uhai Ishri, and then we'll move into our question. Thanks. Thanks, Sarah.
Yeah. Good donor practices that I've seen during this COVID-19 period, or rather practices that I think have worked, are number one, flexibility. We've seen more donors, certainly Uhai Ishri, we've been even more flexible than before. We have undertaken to listen more to what our communities are telling us, knowing that this is not something that we have, any of us have dealt with before, but we have decided to learn fast, like usual, from what the community is telling us, what the needs are.
Kwa kipindi hiki cha corona, kilitupa mtetemo mkubwa sana. Kwanza ni ugonjwa ambao ulikuja kwa mshtuko na ugonjwa ambao uliwaumiza watu. Kwetu Tanzania, kwa watu ambao tunafanya kazi za ngono na pia tunaoishi ugonjwa wa kimwi, ilikuwa ni changamoto kubwa sana. Kuwa kwamba dawa pia kupatikana ilikuwa ni tabu.
We have taken an approach of listening to what the community is saying, listening to what approaches they think would work.
6 months prior to the COVID-19 pandemic hit, we started doing HIV testing for the MSM community. According to our current data, 1 in 5 from those who got tested within the last 9 months were found to be HIV positive. More than half of these individuals do not have a stable job or source of income, which means that they are suffering the most during this.
The changes in practice that we have put in place have been changes towards the kind of grants that we've given and the kind of grants that the kind of proposals that have been received. So for example, knowing that it is difficult for people during a pandemic to think about the long term, to think about projects or programs in the long term without knowing how the future would look like.
The shifts and the experience that COVID-19 has highlighted our HIV programming at Icebreakers Uganda is that it has made the LGBT community more vulnerable in terms of limited access to HIV-related services.
We have thought about getting support to people that allows them to think and do things as they come up. So we're thinking about more core costs. We are thinking about just giving grants which are really flexible and unrestricted, that allows communities that have, you know, communities and organizations that have a good track record to be able to implement things as soon as the need arises.
Mais aussi nous demandons aussi aux bailleurs d'être très rapides aux réponses quand il s'agit de donner les réponses sur les subventions qu'on a données, car c'est une crise qui demande d'être plus rapide dans le soutien et l'appui des organisations partenaires. En tant qu'ONG communautaire, nous devons rester à côté des membres et être solidaires pour que les activités puissent continuer, mais aussi pour que nous puissions se prévenir de la pandémie.
We have really tried to put out grants faster than before. For KP organizations, you are the communities and organizations on the ground. You know what the needs are. Always stick to articulating your needs. Do not let the funding that is available be the one that determines what you tell funders you need.
We will continue educating all LGBT community members about their sexual health with regards to risky sexual behaviors, with much emphasis on HIV, AIDS and STIs, as well as promoting their fundamental rights.
Advice I would give to funders to be able to relate better with KP organizations would first be to just be more participatory in the approaches in funding. The communities and organizations on the ground really do know what they need, really do have the capacity to make decisions on how resources should be used and distributed.
Hello everyone.
Great. Thank you. And thank you, Uhai Ishtri, for such a great video. It's really good advice and really thought-provoking. I believe there is so much we know already about good practice, and that's led us to this next question. So this is a question that I'll invite John to ask two of the panelists. I'm going to introduce them all now. So John Barnes is from Funders Concerned About AIDS. And then we've got Mohan, who's from MPact. Mohan Sundararaj is Director of Public Health and Programs at MPact. And Judy, who's also going to answer and respond to this question, is Executive Director of the International Network of People Who Use Drugs. Thanks. I'll hand over to you now, John. John, are you there?
Sorry, I'm having some technical difficulties here. I'll try that again. So the question is for Mohan and Judy. What can donors do to make investments more aligned with the needs of key populations and communities and organizations that serve them? And can you provide an example of positive donor engagement or practice that you've experienced?
Great, thanks, John. This is Mohan. I can go first. I guess first I should just really thank funders concerned about AIDS for envisioning such an important session for HIV 2020. And thanks, Kate, for being truly open to creating a space that's free and open for debate and discussion and for inviting MPact. I think the question of what can donors do to make investments more aligned with needs of communities needs to begin with why do we need funding? And I think funders and communities need to be on the same page that we're really talking about funding for three things: funding to deliver services, funding to break down barriers, and funding to build community. I think as recently as 2 years ago, over half of new HIV transmissions were recorded among key populations. And in some regions, our communities accounted for 95% of new infections. And yet, between 2016 and 2018, when the total funding for HIV programs was approximately $57 billion, funding for key population programming was only $1.3 billion. And I think we have quite a ways to go in terms of aligning EPI data with level of funding for an HIV response. And so I'll echo what my organization MPact has been saying ever since it was born, and that is to put communities in charge of delivering services. Yes, we need resources to deliver services, but we also need resources to break down structural barriers like we saw in that video and like many speakers have been kind of echoing this week at HIV 2020. And I think in that regard, we would really like to see donors really understand the need to fund programs designed to take down structural barriers and to do so not only when it's politically expedient, but also to do it in the most comprehensive manner possible. And then finally, I'll just say that I think Shaun said it better. We need resources to build community, of which HIV 2020 is a good example, and there's many great examples of when that has happened. Donors who supported HIV 2020 took a stand against power and supported the resistance of community. So I would say that funders should continue to enthusiastically fund conferences, meetings, gatherings, workshops, and trainings, because what they're really doing is building community. And that's never been more important than now at a time when we have shared struggles such as those emanating from systemic and structural racism and from botched national level and global level responses to COVID-19. And then finally, John, I think a great and unique and powerful example of positive donor engagement or practice, I would say for us, is Bridging the Gaps, led by AIDS Funds and financed at 82 million euros by the Dutch Foreign Ministry for 9 years. Bridging the Gaps was a robust key population-led response that was implemented across 16 countries at any given time and at global, regional, and country levels in nearly every world region from 2011 to 2020. Very simply put, key population communities served on the Bridging the Gaps board and thus were engaged in all levels of decision-making in the development of programs, program theories of change, and even in the division of budget across the consortium. The donor really was a thought partner, a facilitator, and a collaborator. And it was also a donor that took a more fluid and comprehensive approach to funding with an understanding that core operating costs need to be supported, knowing that they are clearly linked to outputs and impact necessary to make a difference. In addition, taking the long-term view meant funding in 5 or 10-year cycles instead of 1 or 2 years of start-stop funding, like most donors are inclined to do. It also meant that the donor understood that we have to swim upstream to have impact, but that impact may take several years to become evident. So like the Bridging the Gaps program, we might also look to places like the ViiV Positive Action Fund for gay men and trans people that Shaun leads, the Robert Carr Fund, named after MPact's co-founder, or the Elton John AIDS Foundation's LGBT Fund for additional positive examples. And before I pass it on to Judy, I think I'll just finish by saying that as we think about funding for HIV, we need to think about HIV within the sexual and reproductive health and rights of our communities. And that's because the health of our communities cannot be separated from our human rights. Thank you.
Thanks, Mohan.
Thanks, Mohan. And just to echo Mohan's thanks as well, big thank you to Funders Concerned About AIDS and ViiV Health Positive Action for creating this space for a dialogue between grantees and donors, which is very much needed. Just to reflect a bit, we know that we are at a critical juncture of the HIV response and we're all expected to do more with less. And it's in this context that, you know, it's more important than ever that money is being invested in the most effective way, that it is reaching places where it's needed the most, and it gets into the hands of organizations that can reach and speak to the needs of key populations. And that's networks of gay and bisexual men, people who use drugs, sex workers, transgender people, and people living with HIV. So just in terms of epi data, I mean, there was the latest UNAIDS report, Seizing the Moment, that was launched 3 days ago, which shows, you know, an uptick of 62% of new infections occurring amongst key populations. So in this context, we know it's more important than ever that HIV funding reflects the state of the epidemic and that it's grounded in this evidence rather than, you know, what we see now that it's very, you know, it can be based on political and moralizing agendas that would prefer to pretend that we don't exist. So just for INPUD, the International Network of People Who Use Drugs, we're the global peak body representing people who use drugs. Like many of the other global key population-led networks, we do lead consortiums and provide onward granting to regional and national networks. And even though our core business is global advocacy, we've taken on some of this subgranting given the difficulties of getting drug user-led organizations funded, simply because unfortunately, often donor requirements can be stringent and it makes it impossible for many regional and national organizations to get funded. And this is because being a criminalized population, many networks, some of the difficulties that we face that we're not able to, or many networks are not able to register in their own countries or open bank accounts. In some instances, some of the activities we need to be carrying out as communities, such as distributing life-saving commodities, such as drug using paraphernalia and naloxone is illegal. In this sense, if donors are truly dedicated to ensuring that funding directly reaches community and genuinely believe in community leadership, there needs to be the flexibilities generated within grant making. There needs to also be the appetite for risk. You know, we can't always just see things through the lens of potential liabilities, and also be willing, especially for criminalized populations, and we have to be willing to think outside of the box. So just to give a bit of an understanding of community-led organizations, many of us are very stretched resource-wise. There are many competing demands. We often have to spend our time firefighting emergencies. You know, there isn't the luxury of dedicating resources for consultants to write fancy proposals, things like this. We know it's not an equal playing field. So it's really important that donor and grantee structures and practices and the way that they deliver grants, if they're really genuine about supporting key population leadership, that they take on good donor practices. And some of these are to make sure that, funding for community-led organizations and networks, they need to be specifically earmarked. Eligibility requirements shouldn't inadvertently exclude key population-led networks due to our criminalized status and should be adapted. You know, there should be the appetite for adapting where necessary. As Mohan mentioned, you know, we need longer running funding cycles. We can't underestimate the need for secure funding for networks. And of course, a sufficient portion of this should be dedicated and available for core funds and core costs. Funding should be flexible enough to cover necessities related to HIV infection, HIV prevention and treatment, such as food and medical supplies. And we should also be able to reallocate when unforeseen circumstances come up. And of course, you know, we've all seen this with COVID-19. Funds should be available for capacity building and organizational strengthening, including financial management, governance, and membership engagement. Unlike other NGOs, we are accountable to our constituencies. And, you know, sometimes I think there's, not enough understanding of how much, you know, time and effort this does take. Just to echo Mohan as well, of course, it's important that funds are allocated towards advocacy and campaigning in addition to services, because it's highly unlikely that governments that criminalize us are going to be supporting networks of gay and bisexual men, people who use drugs, sex workers, and transgender people to be holding them accountable. I think another thing we would ask is that, you know, donors also leverage political influence to amplify and champion decrim, the realization of our rights, and also be really vocal about the importance of funding community-led responses. We know that it's not just a matter of principle, but it's also smart investment. The universal health coverage was mentioned, of course, in the political declaration. It mentions that the last mile needs to be put first. You know, communities are able to detect early, respond quickly, and play important watchdog functions to government transparency and accountability. So finally, just in finishing this piece, you know, we just know what works better for communities. We understand the reasons for why people may not be engaging in programs when they are available, because as we know, there's not sufficient funding for a lot of these services. We can communicate effectively with peers, and we adapt and innovate, you know, when it's needed rather than for the sake of it. So just to, you know, mention some good donor practices, you know, I think it's hard to give one example. We're funded by many of the donor agencies that Mohan's already mentioned, and I think they come with, you know, different strengths. So the Robert Carr Fund, you know, they do provide core funding, and a large component is on community mobilization and empowerment, which is important. The Global Fund Community Rights and Gender Strategic Initiative, you know, a component of this is solely dedicated to funding key population networks, and this is done without compromise. And also, you know, to mention ViiV as well, their positive action challenge recently focused on harm reduction, also prioritized drug user-led networks. And of course, the Bridge in the Gaps program, funded by the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs, that the key population grantees are on the program board. And I think also they've really leaned into the diversity of the program as well. So, you know, the program is flexibly determined according to community needs.
Thanks. Back to you, Kate.
Sorry. Thanks, John. That's such good answers and such so thought provoking. And I think we're already hearing that there are many, many things that are being done already by funders that they can do more of, which will be very supportive. On the question that Mohan and Judy both alluded to, I want to draw your attention to a report that's coming out from AIDS Funds, Fast Track or Off Track, about how insufficient funding for key populations jeopardizes the 2030 targets. There's one example they found, which was that although the risk of acquiring HIV for gay and bisexual men was 22 times higher than for all adult men in 2018, programs targeting this group received less than 1% of the amount spent on the overall HIV response in lower middle income countries between 2016 and 2018. So despite the fact we struggle with data on this, but I think the AIDS Funds is going to be drawing attention to these questions of funding really in a really important way. We're moving on. We still welcome questions on that we can come back to. before we move to the next question, I'd like to introduce the next video. And this comes from John Kimani, who's from the Kenyan network of people who use drugs. So I'll hand over to Sarah to share the film now.
Hello, everyone. My name is John Kimani. I'm the director of Kenyan Network of People Who Use Drugs. Today I'm here to talk about good. Good donor practices. One is that there have been continuous communication between the implementers and donors. Secondly, is that there has been monitoring and program visits, which has really helped in learning more about projects. Third is that there has been clear guidelines, tools, and contracts on how implementation should work. What we'd love to see in future is that there should be community engagement and involvement during.
Oops. I think we lost the end of John's statement there.
It cut off quick, but that was the end.
Oh, that was the end. I think that we maybe edited it slightly at the end, but I do appreciate hearing directly from the people that made these films for us. So, and I know it takes time and thought. So thanks to John Kimani and the Kenyan Network of People Who Use Drugs for that. So now we're moving on to the next question, which is bringing in the COVID context, but in a slightly different way. So our discussant for this is Jacob Arman, who is Program and Communications Coordinator for the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation. Welcome, Jacob. And he'll be talking to Gavin Reid, who's the lead on community engagement for the Community Rights and Gender Department of the Global Fund, and also getting a response from Stella, who's a board member along with me for a funders concerned about AIDS. And Stella is the Stella Bosile is the co-executive director, UHI East African Sexual Health and Rights Initiative. Thanks, Jake. I'll hand over to you now.
Thank you. So my question to Gavin and Dr. Stella is, so what are the changes in practice due to COVID that have actually helped you as a grantee or funder? And of those changes, what do you think could be kept for the long term? Examples of short-term changes that have been popular, including at ETAF, include funding more core costs or rapid release of funds and simplified grant applications. And then the final component of my question would be similar to UNAIDS initiative, Build Back Better. How can we create, or how do we maintain a more sustainable and long-term relationship between funders and grantees? Thank you, I'll turn it over to you.
Jake, you want me to start? I could start. All right, thank you so much. It's lovely being in this session. And Jake, even before I delve into the short and the long term and what are the lessons learned so far, I think one of the things that COVID has been able to do is just really scale up the exposing of the inequalities that exist, particularly around health and economic inequalities. And here focusing on key and vulnerable populations. One of the things that we have seen within this region, in the Eastern African region, is that while this has been a pandemic, a health issue, we've seen a continuation of infringement of human rights. We've seen governments being able to scapegoat public health interventions to be able to arrest LGBTIQ and sex work communities. We have actually seen LGBTIQ and sex workers being forced to live within families where they've been socially excluded, and this has actually exposed them more in terms of the violence that they need to. The other thing that has also been exposed is the realities around deprioritization of investments to healthcare around key and vulnerable and marginalized populations, and not just in the Eastern African region, in the whole African continent, that when this pandemic came out, the government went into the silo of the general population, not thinking about the special needs or the special requirements around LGBTIQ, particularly thinking gender non-conforming, trans-identifying individuals, and just seeing how that has really impacted negatively the access to health as a right for our populations and our communities. In terms of what UHI has been able to do, I keep telling people that UHI has never had a COVID fund. Why? It's because Wuhai's DNA is actually embedded in listening to the communities. Wuhai's decision-making bodies has always been representatives of the communities who come to the table and are able to define what the problems are. So even when people were, I mean, other institutions and other organizations are developing a COVID-specific fund, this is the pushback that Wuhai as an activist-led fund has always done. We've always pushed for a bottom-top approach in terms of grant-making. We've always said, where is the voice of the community in terms of these decisions that are being made? Because the community is able to define the problems, the communities then are able to tailor make solutions based on the needs. And this is actually a sustainability. Yes.
I'm so sorry to interrupt you, but we're getting a very pleading request from the translators. You slow down because they're translating into other languages. You're very
sorry about that.
Please continue.
I mean, when the spirit leads, the spirit leads. Like, you know, it's going. I'm sorry to the translators. Let me slow down. So for example, I mean, I was talking about how Ohio has never had a COVID fund, right? And the reason why we've never had a COVID fund is that we've always been community specific and our ears have always been on the ground towards our grassroots organizations. We have always had to listen to them. We've let them. In fact, if you look at our governing structure, our communities sit and decide how resources are able to be utilized. And this way, we have actually just really responded to the real needs of the communities. The other thing that we've looked at in terms of handling this is that we have to be cognizant of the fact that COVID, while it's a health issue, it cannot just be looked at independently. This is a multifactorial disease that affects multiple factors. That we can't underpin or undermine the place for social justice. We can't undermine the place for the continuous advocacy around a rights-based approach to human rights issues, HIV and AIDS being one of the areas, that we can't undermine the fact that economic justice is also something that we need to speak about and we need to be able to address. And that can only be learned, we can only hear those voices, we can only hear that when our communities are actually speaking about. The other thing that we've done in terms of short-term and long-term is that we've always strived as Wuhai Ishtri to be able to reduce our grantee burden in terms of application and proposals. And this has actually become a reality right now, that while we have, for us in the region, we've worked on trust for our communities, even when we do our risk management and risk mitigation, we've always believed that our communities are self-correcting, that when there is a problem, the community should be able to lead. So trusting the communities has also become something very vital that we have to think about. And then acceleration, the speed at which grants are given. Here is an emergency issue. Here is that we are having people who cannot be able to access their ARTs because clinics have been closed, because there are curfews. Some of them cannot be able to expose themselves. Why? Because, of course, the stigma and discrimination and criminalization of same sex relationship and sex work within our region. So one of the things that you're able to do is, can you get the grants out as fast as possible? I mean, for us, we've been trying to beat a 48-hour deadline or at most 72-hour deadline. Can we push for that from philanthropy? And then the other thing also we've done as Wuhai is, as part of listening to the communities, we've recognized the online space as a very important space for advocacy, as a very important space for documentation and exposure of human rights issues. That even right now, when our communities cannot be able to access HIV commodities, then when these issues are actually brought about to the online space, we've seen other relative institutions or other relative bodies or partners coming in and speaking. We've had UNAIDS even giving a public statement about this discrimination that is ongoing against LGBTIQ and other marginalized population. Then can we be able to give a general support grant because of the flexibility? Because then that is, in that way, we are able to listen, we are able to let the communities address the specific issue. I mean, it's time we actually did away with program-based grant making, right? Because it's not only redundant, but it's also inefficient. The most effective way in which you can actually support communities is to be able to give them grants that they define how it is that they utilize these grants. The realities about core support right now, the realities about operational costs have actually become real right now because a lot of the money was tied into programs. And finally, I mean, the other thing that we've also done in terms of short term, and this has to also be prolonged in terms of the long term, is partners speak to each other. We have multiple donor forums where we've spoken to each other. That way, we're able to effectively and efficiently invest dollar per dollar into our communities instead of also, excuse me, we've been able to invest dollar per dollar to our communities, and if, and that has resulted in efficient utilization of the monies. So that those are the things that as Wuhai we've been able to learn around right now in COVID response, and the intersectionality around disease and human rights and social justice cannot also be undermined.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sella. And Gavin, would you like to add?
Great. Thanks, Jake. So at the Global Fund, we're very concerned about the impact of COVID. In our latest survey of 106 countries, 3/4 of programming for HIV, TB, and malaria is being impacted. And we're concerned about the vulnerability of those living with the three diseases, but also others that are most marginalized and vulnerable in society, both from the direct impact of COVID, but also the disruption of other services. And in addition, we're concerned about that COVID might be being used through lockdowns or targeting of key and vulnerable populations, as well as issues around increased gender-based violence. So in terms of what have we done that's innovative to respond to this, the Global Fund has made available $1 billion to support countries to respond to COVID through two channels: grant flexibilities of $500 million and COVID-19 response mechanism. The grant flexibilities are flexibilities within grant savings that are submitted by the PR, not CCMs, and although CCM endorsement is encouraged, but the C19 RM flexibilities to be submitted by the CCM. And it's very important that communities and civil society understand the differences, because they should definitely be engaged in the shaping and development of the C19 RM applications. And they should be able to access funding to support interventions to mitigate the impact of COVID-19 on HIV, TB, and malaria. Also actions to support the response to COVID itself, as well as any initiatives to improve community systems. I must closely work with the Community Rights and Gender Strategic Initiative. And as Judy mentioned earlier on, that allows for a percentage of funding to be allocated towards core costs, as well as operational costs, in addition to the activities that it funds. As a result of COVID-19, we have pre-approved reprogramming of in the range of 10 to 15% of all allocated funds without any further approval, to because we understand that the situation is rapidly developing. In addition, we've supported other community partners such as GMP Plus, who are working closely with ICW, Y Plus, UNAIDS, WHO, UNICEF, Avert, AIDS Funds, and Frontline AIDS, to develop and implement an alert system on the impact of COVID-19 on human rights focused on people living with HIV. So there's a number of direct initiatives that we can do. I think also the importance of understanding that we need, that there is increased communication, and some of that it's important to see if we can structure, but a lot of it isn't structured. However, we don't all need to be creating the same wheels. And for example, the key population networks, MPact, INPUD, NSWP, and GATE have developed regularly updated resources around COVID-19 on their website. So for us, it's really important that we're able to direct their communities to the information that they're managing to synergize and turn into a format that's most accessible to their communities. I think some of the advantages that we've seen from COVID-19 is a huge move into how we can better use technology and data. And that brings with it some challenges around ensuring the safety and security, including data privacy and protection of identity for key and vulnerable populations. But it's also increased engagement opportunities through online events, through online surveys, and allowing us to document the inputs into funding request development processes that we didn't have that ability beforehand. It's also given greater access to consultants and writing teams in country. And we're excited about some of those possibilities. Again, there are additional challenges, and particularly in ensuring people are able to have both hardware and software, as well as data, to be able to engage in those forums. But we think that those are some exciting possibilities that would be useful to explore as we go forward. Jake, I think I'll probably pause there and then look forward to engaging with participants. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, all of you. I think there's a huge amount, both of issues that COVID is creating, but also very creative solutions that it's creating. And it's great to hear that flexibility and being more open to core costs that's happening as a reaction and a support. I also really like the point that somebody picked up in the chat as well, that Stella said that if you're a funder that's already responsive and you with your ear to the ground and able to be flexible, you don't have to have a special COVID fund because you're already doing everything that might be needed from a COVID fund. And I think that's a really good point. So now, before we move to the third question, we're going to see the third video, which is from Karina. Karina is the regional coordinator of the Latin American platform of persons who perform sex work. And so I'll hand over to Sarah behind the scenes to play us.
Here we go, everybody. One second.
Hello, my name is Karina Bravo. I'm the regional coordinator of the platform for sex workers. Right now, due to COVID-19, key populations and the people who live with HIV/AIDS have new necessities. It's not only in terms of healthcare access or taking medications for HIV, but also in regards to basic needs, such as food, shelter, how to deal with fear, how to get a job, and how that allows us to keep putting food on the table for our families. It is essential to both see and listen to what key populations are saying, particularly in these times of everyday life post-COVID. It's crucial to put oneself in our shoes, try to understand our realities, our needs, and our context. So it is really important to be more human.
Thank you to Karina for submitting that film. And I think the point she was making right at the end, which spoke a lot to me, is about being more humane is key. I think that's something we all aspire to, really. So now I'm going to hand over to Shaun Mellors from Positive Action to ask a question. And he's going to be speaking to three people. So he's going to be speaking to Vera, who we haven't heard from yet, Vera Rodriguez, who's a program associate for the Red Umbrella Fund. And he's also going to be hearing again from Judy from INPUD and Mohan from MPact. So I'll hand over to you now, Shaun. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Kate. Really interesting discussion going on, and hopefully there is going to be opportunity to hear from some of the participants who are attending this session, because my question kind of emphasizes the concept of a dialogue. And when I talk about dialogue, it's really about meaningful dialogue. So my question to the three panelists is, what advice would you give to us as donors to relate better to KP organizations? Mohan and Judy have already made a few references to that, but practically, what does that look like and what does that feel like in terms of making us as donors more receptive to your needs?
But at the same time, is there any advice that you would be able to give to KP-led community organizations to help them relate better to donors? So to help us move beyond the rhetoric and the buzzwords and really have meaningful dialogue and discussion. So perhaps let me begin with Vera, and then I'll come to Judy and then to Mohan.
Thank you so much. Yes, thank you so much. I want to thank obviously to Funders Concerned About AIDS for organizing this very important and needed panel. But of course, I also want to acknowledge and say a big thank you to HIV 2020 for organizing this alternative conference, which is also a protest and a celebration. And lastly, I also want to thank to the audience, because we are here right now, 175 people, and we are all coming from different backgrounds, but we are mainly people from community and funders. So what a great opportunity to talk a little bit on such an important question. In fact, I think it's one of the $100 million question if we're talking about money. My name is Vera Rodriguez. As it's been shared, I'm a program associate of the Red Umbrella Fund. I have the portfolio of Latin America and Europe. I have been also a sex worker myself for 16 years, and I have been in activist spaces for nearly a decade. First, I want to say briefly that the Red Umbrella Fund is led by and for sex workers. That means that, and I will go into more detail later on, but that means that in our secretariat, we have community members, and also our international steering committee has community members and funders so that we can learn from each other. And we have a group, an advisory committee that comes and chooses themselves where the money goes. First, I want to talk a little bit about the differences between being a funder and being a community member, and as someone who has been in both spaces, I think I can talk by my lived experience. I want to talk a little bit about the differences to see how we can bring them a little bit closer so we can all build together a better future. Funders, we have salaries. This is something I never had before when I was doing sex work. Funders, we have safety. Funders, we have access to the resources. This is something that most key populations do not have. They do not have the salaries. They do not have the safety. They do not have the resources. But I want to highlight that the key populations are the gatekeepers for social change. Funders, we have the tangible power, but community has the force, the ultimate power to make things happen. And they will do it regardless there is funding or not. So we need to acknowledge as funders where the real power lies. Then, so that we see two bodies that have two very different lifestyles, we have we speak two very different languages. So how are we getting to a situation where migrant Karina Plappert is saying that we need to be more human? Perhaps we can review our processes. And this is my message to funders. I will start with a very beautiful quote from Judy Chang on her opening space, which is, HIV 2020 is a space to protest against top-bottom approaches. Now I'm going to ask to funders, are you also doing a top-bottom approach when it comes to grant making? And I'm going to exemplify that if we as funders find an NGO that it's very easy to fund, that is registered, but is not community led, and is that NGO that is implementing the programs, the community, the key populations become the target and not the trust that we need. And the trust that we need gets erased because then they become just numbers. So what is this giving an NGO so that the NGO gives to the key population? This is a top-bottom approach. And this is a power dynamic that we need to overcome. It's very easy to name it. It's not easy to overcome it. But here we are having this very important conversation. At the Red Umbrella Fund, and as with other community-led funders, we facilitate the space where the community decides how the money is going to be implemented, how which groups are going to be funded. So by facilitating that space, we are already having a conversation and they are being part of the circle. And therefore, we can easily feed the grassroots movements, supporting them from below. And this is what we need. We need healthy funding movements. We need to fund healthy movements. Social movements are important because we cannot leave anyone behind. Of course, I want to mention the hack list that has been mentioned in the call that is being developed by the three self-led funds, the siblings funds that we call, which are UHAI and the Third Wave Fund that is not here today but has done tremendous work as well on that hack list. And I want to mention as well that we as funders have been able to sit down and organize through the Sex Worker Donor Collaborative. So there are ways to do things better. In the Sex Worker Donor Collaborative, we learn from each other and we support each other. But we went even further. We organized a webinar and we partnered with the movement, with the NSWP, in order to amplify the voices of the sex workers. That is what funders need to do, need to listen to community.
Great, thank you very much, Vera. We'll come back to you in a few minutes, because I just want to give Judy and Mohan an opportunity to comment as well, and it's really refreshing and encouraging to see your passion in the words that you speak and in the work that you do. So thank you very much for that. Judy, could I come to you, please, and then I'll come back to Vera after Mohan.
Sure, everyone can hear me. Okay, well, yeah, I guess to answer the question first, I would say, you know, I think a lot of the times, key population communities were on the brunt end of respectability politics. And I am taking from your tweet, Shaun, where, you know, we as criminalized populations and networks of criminalized populations are told that in order to, you know, get proper treatment from a group in power, that somehow we must behave better. So I think, you know, that's a, you know, unfair burden kind of placed on us. You know, at times there can be, you know, a lack of trust and more scrutiny we found as well, especially as networks of people who use drugs. So which is why, again, of course, dialogues and building up relationships such as in this forum are very important. Obviously we all face different demands and pressures. But I do think for donor agencies to better relate to community-led networks, it also takes a change in thinking and a wider lens view of what amplifying change looks like. Our work as movements, as networks, doesn't always neatly fit into, you know, current performance metrics, and the nature of, you know, what we do is not linear, but it's fluid and dynamic. And I think that needs to be seen as a strength. We do operate under immense constraints, criminalization, stigma, discrimination, and this, of course, is going to affect and impact our work externally and internally. And of course, we are resilient in fighting back against this, but we also face, you know, when we are at the decision-making table, that we have to work twice as hard to be listened to, and that there are all sorts of tactics and strategies in these settings to somehow, diminish our voice. Of course, under criminalization, we also face imprisonment of our leaders, burnout and stress, but this comes with, you know, a group that is very personally invested in our work. As, you know, as networks, we are accountable and we represent a global community. We are pluralistic and we have to hold space for a diversity of ideas and strategies and passions, and we have to bring them together under one umbrella. And this, you know, is not an easy feat. This is why, you know, when we focus only on top-down results-based outcomes or quantitative indicators, they don't truly capture the essence and the value and the successes of the work that networks do. So, you know, I think a solution that we need to be looking towards is looking at how do we co-create the objectives that we're working towards? How do we, you know, co-create how we measure success and define outcomes? And this should be done in partnership with grassroots communities as well. I think there needs to be a reduction in administrative burdens because, you know, this limits, especially for grassroots communities, this limits, you know, our ability to do our work. You know, when more time is spent in the office than it is in the field, for example, it's, you know, filling out, for example, I don't know, timesheets, requiring timesheets, you know, is not always the most effective use of our time. I think also heavily administrative and burdensome reporting can backfire and also cripple networks. We've seen this before, sometimes in the history of the networks, that, you know, co-option and bureaucratization in the long term, you know, kills what makes networks and movements special and effective in the first place, you know, being responsive and flexible and capacity to innovate and adapt. And I think, you know, to networks or message to networks that, yes, I mean, there is, you know, differential power dynamics, but it is really important to be able to, you know, define your priorities and, you know, push back against things that are imposed, because I think if it's a misfit between, you know, what's expected, unrealistic expectations, and what can, you know, be carried out, you know, given resources and time, et cetera, that will, you know, ultimately, you know, lead to negative outcomes. And just overall, yes, I mean, you know, when networks do start to get funded, obviously the structures looking at organizational development, I mean, there are, you know, we are a network for a reason, you know, to reach out to your networks, other key population networks as well, to be able to, you know, share resources.
Great, thank you, Judy. Some really helpful insights and comments there. Mohan, I'm going to ask you to hopefully build on what Judy said, and in particular around the concept of co-creation, because I think that many donor-grantee relations are quite transactional. There's a call for proposals, grantees apply to that. But how do you think this co-creation can become something more real, more alive?
Yeah, thank you, Shaun. I think I'll have to kind of agree with what Vera and Judy just said. I think that was really eloquently put. I would say part of it is really, you know, sort of getting to know each other and inspiring confidence, I think, with each other. So before, you know, even community-based organizations make an ask, I think we should get to know our donors and see what ticks them and get them excited about a project or a piece of work. And I think not every donor has to like everything that you do, and different donors might be interested in various aspects of your work. And I think just kind of having that sort of initial conversation about what really excites you know, the two parties and where their synergy, I think, is really important. And inside of that, I think it's important to also produce quality work and really kind of let your quality really be your best calling card when it comes to donors. I think part of co-creation is also imagining bold and new partnerships. I think partnerships often worries people because it means a smaller piece of the pie if you have to share resources with other organizations. But I would say that there is power in numbers. And so if you can assemble a few organizations and get them excited about your idea, you know, it might be possible that you could pitch for a bigger pot of funding than you wouldn't have been able to go by yourself. And I think finally, I would say that it's really important to kind of stay committed, aligned with mission, staying true to your principles, staying true to your community, even if it sometimes means letting go of an opportunity for funding. But while it is important to stay focused, we also have to kind of change with the times and adapt and be aware that the landscape and the language is changing around us constantly. And I think to the extent that in which we can together participate in those conversations, I think will determine how prepared we might be able to be to mobilize resources for our communities and to have our communities be part of those changes.
Great, Mohan, thank you very much. Vera, I'm going to come back to you to have the last input in this panel. As part of your input at the beginning, talking about HIV 2020 being the alternative conference, I thought HIV 2020 was the real conference and AIDS 2020 is the alternative conference. But can you talk just a little bit about the concept of co-creation? Because I imagine it's something that you do quite well as a funder. What are some of the principles and the values behind that?
Thank you, and I agree. This is the real conference. So thank you for pointing that out. This is not an imagination what I am talking about. This is the reality, and we were set up in 2012, and we are growing. And we are developing ourselves, and we have what we call a participatory grant-making system in which we facilitate a space where 12 to 11 activists review the applications that are eligible to us. And I also take the opportunity to say that we have our call open until the end of the month if there is any sex work-led group in there. This is challenging, but it feels fair. It's challenging because it's a long process, but I want to believe that 11 people that are on the ground will take better decisions about money than myself, now that I have been sitting for 3 years in an office. And that's how we do it. We do it every year. And not only us, there is the Disability Rights Funds, there is the International Trans Funds, there is Frida, which is a young feminist fund. And what I'm talking is not about an utopia. What I'm talking is about what we do every day and what I believe in. So check us out, but also try and partner with peer funders that may have other visions as well, because I have found the Sex Worker Donor Collaborative a very useful space to learn from each other and to support each other. But also we have taken the opportunity and we broke the silos when we were meeting weekly regarding the COVID crisis. And we decided indeed, as I mentioned, to amplify the voices of the community. That's what I think. It's not what we can do. That's what I think the role of philanthropy should be.
Thank you, Vera. And listening to you speak, I'm in awe of the way that you do the work and the way that you have activists who are part of your peer review mechanisms to engage and make decisions. It's quite a big responsibility on those 11 people, I imagine. But is there perhaps an advantage in being an identity-based funder versus, for example, a funder like Positive Action, which tries to focus on community-based responses and covers a variety of identities and populations. Would you advise us as a donor to have a slightly different approach or a very similar approach?
I think it's a very interesting question indeed, because even, yes, there is a lot of potential in having identity having set up a fund based on identity, but there are also some challenges, because when you also do politics on identity, you fix on one side of the issue. While I think sometimes having a more versatile approach can also allow you to fund in a more intersectional way. We do intersectional thinking at the Red Umbrella Fund, but what we fund, but our mission is to strengthen the movement. And for that reason, we only fund self-led groups that are chosen by community themselves. That is what our ISC tells us. And that's what we do it. But I see so much potential in other funding pools that can actually fund in a more intersectional way, because we are not only one identity. We are many identities. And I think when oppressions and impacts of oppression come with two of our identities, that is even one step further that we need to make even more efforts to not leave behind to any of those people most impacted by oppression. Does this answer your question? I hope so.
Yes, it does. And it also brings up so many more questions, but it's absolutely wonderful to be chatting to you. I only wish that we were all together on a big couch with lots of glasses of wine having the conversation, because I think there's just so many interesting nuggets coming out of the discussion. I have a few more minutes left in the panel, so I am going to ask each of you to identify that one top tip for grantees in engaging with donors. What would that one top tip be for a grantee? And I'm going to start with Mohan.
Shaun, I'm going to jump in a minute because we're doing really well on time. So I wonder if we could ask also Gavin and Stella to have a chance to join in and answer that really good question as well. Is that
sure,
okay?
Sure, yes, sure.
Great.
Yeah, thanks, Shaun, for that question. I mean, I think I would just kind of reinforce what I just said, which I think is really staying committed to our communities. So staying true to our principles, staying aligned with the mission of our organizations, and staying true to our community would be the one tip.
Thanks, Mohan. Judy?
I'm terribly at being put on the spot. But yes,
okay.
Well, yes, yeah, similar to what Mohan said as well, that, you know, it is important to stay connected to communities, but be able to also clarify to donors and be specific if something's, you know, not working or you need something to adapt to change your needs. You know, like, you don't have to stay, you know, silent on it. It is important to, you know, be speaking to the donors and be comfortable enough to say, okay, this is what, you know, I need to be able to support the community in the best way.
Mm-hmm. Great. Good response for being put on the spot, Judy. Apologies for that. Vera.
Yes, thank you. As a funder, I have mixed feelings about giving advice to community, because I just want to highlight that it's the key populations that are, it's their bodies that are getting the impacts of struggle. It's their bodies that are being criminalized by existing. So I find very difficult to try and give advices to people when they don't even have safety. But I will share something humbly, because when I was an activist, I used to mystify the funder. I thought that it was someone really foreign to me. And I was never the one writing proposals, and I was never the one filling up budgets. But if I had understood that the world of the funder is mainly numbers and deadlines, perhaps I would have taken the opportunity when a peer of mine say, do you want to learn the budgeting? Because then I can choose the pools of funding instead of being lucky enough to be approached by a funder and say, yes, we want to fund you. So this is what I would say, but one more thing, let's disrupt philanthropy, because philanthropy needs more community members and activist thinking.
Amen to that. I can totally agree with that. So, Kate, you suggested Gavin and Stella also come into the conversation. So perhaps I can hand back to you to continue the facilitation of the discussion whilst Gavin answers the question.
Sure. Thanks, Shaun.
Thanks, Kate and Shaun. Perhaps just building up from what Vera was just saying, learning from each other. I think communities learning from each other on what works is absolutely invaluable, and reaching out to each other for that coaching and mentorship as well. I think also touching on what Mohan said around partnership, communities and civil society are much stronger together when they work in partnership, when they come with unified priorities and don't go, you know, settle for the funding that they don't want when they should be together advocating for the funding that's necessary for community-led and community-based responses. I would say that there's two cascades that I'm aware of. One is an engagement cascade, and we notice it quite clearly in the Global Fund, where at the beginning of a process, communities are increasingly engaged, and we've been measuring it that, you know, 80% of civil society and communities feel engaged at NSP. It goes down to 70% around funding requests. And then when you get into grant making, there's this kind of black hole where a lot of decisions are made. And I think that we need to address that cascade. There's a second cascade, which is a risk cascade. And, you know, the Global Fund funds often public money, and it comes with a lot of administrative and financial conditions to mitigate risk. And what I noticed is that risk tends to be cascaded downwards, and we need to find ways of addressing that so that, you know, Mohan was talking around the reporting burden, and the reporting burdens are hectic. And, you know, in our conceptualization, that should get weakened as it goes down, but actually everyone passes on the risk downwards. The last two things, I think, don't forget your power. You know, there's an eligibility requirement that communities and civil society need to sign off on funding requests. And if there is exclusion, and if the priorities are not making it into the funding request, then you have power, and don't cede that power easily, you know? And the last element to that is use the civil society, the reps, the developing NGO, the developed NGO, and the community delegations at the board. They carry a lot of weight and power, and so communicate with them as well as with the global networks and regional networks. Thank you.
Thanks, Gavin. And Dr. Stella, remembering to go slowly for the translators.
And go slowly. So this is my closing remark. There is no philanthropy without the communities that are benefiting. So a value proposition is actually at an equilibrium. So that means that for communities to be able to benefit and for philanthropy to actually see the value in the investment, they have to listen to the community. That the power imbalance that exists is actually a distorted power imbalance. That the power lies within the communities who are the consumers of these investments for social impact.
Thank you. I hope we'll hear from you again. We've still got about another half an hour. Before we move into having a more open discussion and getting some questions, we've already had some really good questions that we're going to raise up from the chat and from the questions and answers. But before we move to that, we've got one more film to show you. And this is coming from Samuel Matsikure from the Gays and Lesbians of Zimbabwe. In all cases with these videos, we ask people for their experience and to give us their advice. So this is Samuel's point of view. Thanks, Sarah.
My name is Samuel Matsikure, and I work for Girls and LGBTI Association in Zimbabwe. One of the things that I've learned and experienced in donor and recipient partnership is equal partnership. Equal partnership means at the design of the project, there's already consultation. At budget level, there's already consultation and participation. There's need to respect the context of individuals and adapt the practice is acceptable to both parties. One of the things that I've also learned in the past couple of months is that COVID did not spare any community. We had to adapt to these new changes by making sure that service delivery continue. There are no best or right ways of doing this, especially when you're facing such a catastrophe. We had to adapt to new ways of working and to rethink and reorganize and re-strategize each and every time. We had to also reflect each and every time as we implement our project. We had to renegotiate and reallocate some of the resources to the needs of the communities, but also making sure that the project we had planned continues. Some of the recommendations I would like to make to key population organization is that there's no right way of doing things. Continue to adapt, re-strategize and be innovative during the time of COVID-19, even post-COVID-19 period. Make sure that there's flow of information between the organization, your staff, the community that you serve, and donor partners. It's important to create new partnerships that are able to support some of the needs of the communities that you were not addressing before. There was high demand for food packages, especially among key populations. They were starving. There was need for nutritional support for people living with HIV. And it is important that during this time, we all come together and support each other. This is the time for us all to rally together and save our community.
Well, you would almost think that we had planned it. I think that what Samuel said there in so many ways summarized and echoed so much of what has been said by that panel on the third question. So bravo to Samuel for that. We must give him great thanks for his observations. So now we have about half an hour for some questions and discussions, and we've already identified some that have come up. We have somebody chatting on the Q&A who would like to ask a question in Spanish. And it's not easy to translate in the Q&A section for the translators. So she's going to speak in Spanish. So I'll remind those of you who speak English and don't speak Spanish to click on the interpretation box and choose the English option. Sarah, this is new for us, but I'm hoping that you might be able to bring Vanessa in to be able to ask her question.
I am working, it's Veronica Russo. If you're able to raise your hand, perhaps.
And while we're waiting for...
I was
amazed that you opened the microphone. Thank you very much.
Bueno, en sí, el relato como recién mismo lo dijiste vos,
Kate. So, as you just mentioned, Kate, it is really difficult because there were some questions in Spanish, so it's difficult. Imagine then to be able to reach these funds and economical funds. It is difficult to understand in English. So imagine how difficult is that. So I live in, I've been working in South America, And we have thought on teaching, on learning English, but first we need to have resources to learn English, because we don't have resources for learning languages, and we also don't have the time. And sometimes women as activists, we have more many other things rather than learning English. So in that sense, the question is, so what we have been discussing, and I think that some other colleagues, sex workers, key populations, as Judith mentioned, and I am so grateful for her presentation. We really feel that are represented all the sex worker networks. I'm a member of LANPUD, and for us, it's been a struggle. It's been more than 10 years on being able to create us as a network. And today, having the opportunity to have a bilingual secretariat that has an organization of research and investigation, and it is really difficult to be recognized of whatever we say. And this is based in this scientific research with just a few real based investigations. I mean, sometimes we feel, and we have said this in Durban and many other conferences and events. I've been an activist for more than 25 years, and there are plenty of colleagues from Argentina that had represented us. It is really difficult. It's really difficult not knowing the language. And I'm just speaking about Portuguese, because two of them speak Spanish, and Portuguese, these are the two main languages spoken in Latin America and the Caribbean region. So we don't have also use, we're not drug users. And I'm just saying all this and because of the need that I have to, and I'm so grateful that you opened the microphone so the donors listen to this, because I haven't been able to speak with them. So if this new reality, if this new normality that we need to be adapted to is for this to grow, of course, this is the conference that I wanted to be, because I had participated in many more, but being able to get closer and being able to know them, because they know me, but we cannot talk, we cannot communicate on a regular basis. It happens not only to me, and it happens most to my colleagues in Latin America and the Caribbean. So what I want to say is that if this new normality is going to be more human, that would be better. And with that, we can reach many more people. We have more rights. We have rights. We all are humans. And if this new normality, so I can have access to the internet. Thank you. Thank you for all this work that has been done, and I will have that commitment to share this information, and we can have all this, even though you don't speak Spanish. So thank you for giving us this access. Thank you for giving us this. Believe in them, because they will give. They will make the resources be available, and then we will be there not only in the execution of the resources, but we will also give results. So my question is that basically we expect that we have a response on the projects have to be delivered in English, and sometimes we don't know the language, we don't know how to do so, so we need to have the resources. 7 out of 10 people with HIV, they need food. That's it.
Thank you, Veronica. I think we understand very clearly how, with all the barriers that are faced by key population organizations, then having a language barrier on top of that makes it even harder. And we've been talking about power, and I think when we think about the funders that hold the power, it's our responsibility to help overcome the barriers that we can. There are things that are in our control, and there are things that are not in our control, and being able to be adaptable to language needs, I think, is something that is in our control. So we had another question. Before I have some people in mind to invite to speak if they'd like to. But we had another question that was about the experience of people living with HIV with disabilities. And if possible, I'd really like the person who had that question to have a chance to ask that question. Sarah, I don't know if we have their name and if we can invite them to come onto the floor to ask their question.
I will give it a go.
Okay.
Yep. I believe they are unmuted.
If I have to say, I'm disabled plus living with HIV and I'm gay man. So I work in LGBTI community as a program officer. So I just wanted to know that how you are dealing people with people living with HIV plus disability and different identities. So if you anyone could just give a scenario of this community, that would be helpful for me because I am the only one to represent like this in this. It's my first time and also like I am kind of like just wanted to do more for the society and it's. I think you might have heard first time from Nepal that as a youth. So just this is my question.
Thank you. Yeah, that's a really good question. And I'm going to open it to any of the respondents who want to make a comment on this with any experience of good practice they have. Yeah, I may come back to you to ask you to make some recommendations. So maybe be prepared for that. But is there anybody from our panel who would like to respond to that question with any examples? If you don't put your hand up, panel, I may just pick on one of you. Gavin, for example. Gavin, you're on mute if you're talking. Would you be able to respond to that question? Or maybe Shaun?
Kate, it's Shaun. I mean, I think he raises a really important issue, and it's about the intersectionality of identities. A gay man living with HIV who's disabled. And I think what I take away from that is how do we as donors ensure that our processes are open to as many people as possible across those identities. And it is one of the things that I struggle with. So hearing Uhai and the Red Umbrella Fund talk about participatory grant making or co-creation, it sounds incredible and amazing as principles, but that's how I see his question as well in terms of being able to participate in identifying funding priorities and needs and co-creating, particularly for that one identity. But as somebody from a key population who's come into a ivory tower, into an institution, and having those institutional values and principles, which are also very important, and trying to align those together with the values of co-creation and participation and participatory grant making, which in the end addresses the needs of all the intersectionalities and of all people is hard and it's difficult. So if there's advice and guidance out there as to how to be able to do that, it would be really appreciated.
I thanks, Shaun. I think one of the things Shaun said there really hit my heart as well as someone who's worked as a funder for many years, that you can have we are individuals working within institutions and there is an institutional framework around us which we have to work within. And sometimes the thing we have to find is to a way in to make sure that the principles that we want to sort of adjust to or enable are possible within our own institution, right? And sometimes that can be, sometimes that can take time. If you're still available on the mic, I'd love to hear it if you had anything that you'd recommend that is maybe quite specific, just a specific tip or advice to a funder that would enable better funding from the point of view of your experience.
Thank you. And also, like, you know, about SRH or SDGs, like people belonging, like people like me and especially the youth are not so like coming out in our society because of, you know, our societies are kind of, how to say, narrow-minded people. And also for me, it would be grateful if I could join some of the organization very personally. So you guys or the leaders can guide me how to deal with everything. And also I could run different kind of session within my communities, or I could do something else. If you could recommend me something else, I'm just looking forward to, you know, share my story, because I have really deep, long story of myself and I'm still struggling. I am basically kind of like, I am orphan also. So like I have lots of background of history. So this is my first time and I'm quite nervous also while talking to you guys. So it would be great for me if you can, you know, channelize me with somebody else, or, you know, if you could contact me with somebody else so I can talk with them how to work out with this situation, and also I can do something for my people, especially youth. And I have lots of people who are like, yesterday, I think 1 week also, within 1 week, I talked with one of the people, and the disability people, they were disability people, whole one family were infected by HIV, but this kind of issues are not raised in Nepal. And still there is a belief in our society that disabilities people can't have a sex, and people, disabilities people doesn't get infected by this kind of disease. So this kind of, how to say that, back forward thinkings are still on the society. So I just wanted to grow up myself also, come forward as a leading leader. So all my request is that if I could do something with you guys by collaborating or working together, if you can, you know, mentor me, so that would be great. If you can, let me share my story some day, other day. It would be quite, I hope, inspiration to somebody else as a youth. So yeah, thank you.
Thanks. I think that you're on a network of a lot of organizations that will be useful to you. I don't think we can go into a specific conversation about your situation, but it's really, you raise the issue, as Shaun said, about that kind of intersectionality issue, that HIV is not the only experience that people have in their lives. They have many other things. And when we think as funders, we're not always thinking as HIV funders only. John.
Yeah, I just wanted to expand a little bit on that point to say that one of the things I mentioned in the opening is that FCAA is very interested in working within broader philanthropy to highlight issues. And we work mostly in partnership with other affinity groups. And so, you know, and I would encourage grant seekers to think about their work outside of the HIV silo. In this example, there are funders who are specifically interested in disability issues and addressing barriers related to disabilities, whether they're related to HIV or other issues. FCAA, as an example, FCAA is currently engaging with grantmakers in aging to improve the skills of gerontological providers in HIV, and also to improve the skills of HIV providers in caring for older people. And we're looking to do that kind of intersectional work at other intersections as well. And disability rights and disability issues are one example of that.
Thanks, John. And Aditi, I hope you've seen a comment from Mohan on the in the chat box about your situation and who he could put you in touch with. I'm going to move on now because we've got some other colleagues on in the group that we have colleagues from Elton John AIDS Foundation, from AIDS Fonds, and from Gilead. And I'd be really happy if they would like to make a comment or add in to their perspective or tips, or anybody else who'd like to make a comment to let Sarah know. But I don't know, Sarah, if we would be able to bring in Carly or Esther or Giomane.
If any of those funders want to raise their hand, I can unmute you. I don't see any.
I think Jamara has raised her hand from Gilead.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much. At Gilead, we're very honored to participate here at the HIV 2020. And we're also glad to tell all of you that we fund projects. So please contact us at grants@gilead.com. I also speak Spanish, so let me say that in Spanish, please. Gracias a todos. En Gilead estamos abiertos para que por favor puedan participar en subir sus proyectos para tener funding. Les pedimos nos contacten en grants@gilead.com. Muchas gracias. Thank you so much.
Oh, wonderful. Thanks very much. Now, Sarah, last opportunity for a question, because I'm now going to move. We've got about just over 10 minutes left. So I'm going to move to asking our panelists if they'd like to make some closing comments or reflections. But before that, is there any other questions that we'd like to raise up to this discussion that I can mention? I'll take that silence as a no.
Kate, is it okay if we unmute Esther Wonk from AIDS Fonds?
Oh yeah, if she's put her hand, yes. Yeah. She needs to put her hand up so that we can bring her in.
I think she just has, so.
Okay, brilliant. Esther. I think maybe we're having
yes.
Oh, here we go.
Esther. Yeah, you hear me, right?
Yes. Yes, thank you.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Thank you all for your contributions, and thank you for the opportunity. I just wanted to say briefly that we have a piece of research coming up which we commissioned from Bridging the Gaps and Pitch, which is another strategic partnership, and that research is it's kind of looking into funding that is available for key population HIV programming, and it will come out sometime this summer. We don't have a date yet, and as was in the chat earlier, we'll have a session about that at the end of HIV 2020 on 20th of October. But key recommendations that came from that were really that there is definitely, I mean, first of all, a need for more funding, a need for better funding, a need for funding in line with the normative guidance that we have and that we all share, but also that there is a need for much better data collection and tracking and joint target setting. So that kind of alignment between funders is really key. And the study looks into some of the largest funders for HIV, Global Fund, PEPFAR, some of the bilaterals, and then the funders concerned about AIDS also kindly shared all their data. So there's been a lot of collaboration from all those sites, and we're very excited that the report is coming out. We're now in the final stages, and you'll see it all when it comes out.
Brilliant. That's great to hear about that, and we're excited to see the full report. It's so important. Now, I've promised we'll finish on time. So I'm going to, we've got 10 minutes though, so I'm going to give our whole panel, I hope, a chance to say something. I'm going to start with the people who began with their opening statements, and that's Shaun and John, and then we'll move on to the others. So John, you first, then Shaun.
Well, I just want to really thank everybody for this really engaging dialogue. I think we've got some great messages to take back to the funding community. And, you know, I want to just reiterate what I said before about thinking about your work more broadly than HIV. Think about the work that you do in terms of health access, in terms of human rights, in terms of LGBT rights, in terms of criminal justice. There are funders who focus on all of these issues, and they need to be brought into this work, and we would like to be your partner in doing that. Also, think about the resources that we provide as tools for your advocacy. We publish a report each year, which Esther just mentioned, which tracks global philanthropy. Sarah can post a link to that. We try to highlight the gaps between where the funding is and where the funding is needed. We analyze by geography, we analyze by key population, we analyze by intervention. So please use that tool and let us know how we can make it better. We're also really interested in being able to better identify organizations that are for us, by us groups. In the last mile funding report, as part of that effort, we tried to code all of the grantees, thousands of grantees who receive these funds. And it's very hard to come up with a definition for community-based. And so what we would like to do is to try to identify the key population-led groups. And we'd like to partner with the networks represented on this call and with their members in doing that. So more to come on that. Thanks to Kate for putting this together and for moderating, and to Shaun for partnering with us, and to all of our brilliant panelists, and all of you for giving us your time today.
Thanks, John. So Shaun.
Hi, Kate. Sorry, I had a few issues with the video screen there. Yes, it's been an interesting beginning of a dialogue, which I hope we are going to be able to continue. I know that there are platforms and opportunities such as Changing Faces, Changing Spaces, and funders concerned about AIDS meetings, but who knows when those are going to happen again, given our new COVID reality. Positive action is by no means perfect. And we are really trying to have meaningful conversations and discussions with other donors, but also with grantees, to try and ensure that positive action is more relevant and in touch with the communities that we say we serve. And one of the ways in which we try and do that is hopefully through ongoing discussion and communication. And so I do really look forward to continuing some of these discussions in the months ahead, and also just want to appreciate you and John and all the panelists as well. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Shaun. I have had a request, it's 5 minutes to go, from Carly to say something. So I don't know, I'm not sure we've got time, actually. I'm really sorry. I just do want to give people some space. So I'm going to ask Stella now to speak. Sorry, I think we're up against it time-wise. So Stella, let me invite you just to say, you've got about 30 seconds to say something. Thank you.
Well, it was a very meaningful conversation. I think what we need to also, as take home, particularly those of us who are in philanthropy and grant making, we need to have more sit down with our grantees, not necessarily just wait for HIV 2020 to be able to hear and reflect on their thoughts, and also to challenge how philanthropy is made.
Thanks very much. That was brilliant. So, Vera.
I just want to say thank you. And I think also underlying what Stella has said, let's not keep it here. This has been a beautiful moment and a beautiful space. So let's take things further. We are a little bit closer. Let's get closer and closer, because together we're stronger. Thank you.
That's brilliant. And I agree so much. So Mohan.
Thanks, Kit. I think I'll echo the round of applause and appreciation for the session, and really to you for moderating, and for all the funders who were part of the panel as well as who attended. And I think the closing comment, I think increased level of funding is an obvious suggestion, but when that does happen, financing is mostly funneled through big implementers with varying track records working with key populations and little to no track record on human rights. So I would ask funders to imagine the role of community beyond just advocacy, outreach, and mobilization. So this includes funding communities to conduct research, evaluation, and also provide a broad range of comprehensive health services.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mohan. And Judy?
So just a final message, and just echoing what people have said, I think, the discussions here, we need to be looking at how to take them forward and continue to encourage these types of dialogues to work together, because we are all invested in making sure that commitments to HIV are kept, including financial commitments. And also, we should be looking at finding new ways to collaborate, and also continuing to communicate together about the need to continue to invest in HIV and continue to invest more in funding community-led networks, and to really be committed to shifting power.
Brilliant. Thank you, Judy. Jake, moving on to you.
Hi, thank you. First of all, I just want to thank everyone for all the great points. To touch or to revisit two points. One from Judy is that I think that as a funder, we need to not let traditional respectability politics get in the way of shared goals in reaching the communities. And also to touch on Vera's point is that with the increase in data that we're getting, specifically for us as an HIV-specific organization, we can't lose sight of the communities that we want to reach and let them turn into numbers as well.
So, thank you, Jake.
Thank you.
That's all great. Thank you very much. Gavin, thanks.
Yeah, just a big thank you to the organizers of HIV 2020 and Funders Concerned About AIDS, ViiV Healthcare Positive Action, for this session. I really do think that, there is a willingness, certainly there's a willingness from the Global Fund. As we're developing our strategy for the next period, I think it's really important that we look at our policies and mechanisms for funding as well. Because even when there is funding set aside, our policies and mechanisms actually make it very difficult for community-led organizations to access funds.
That's great. Thanks, Gavin. And I feel enormously privileged to have been part of HIV 2020. I can't tell you how what an honor really it is to me. And thank you so much for all your participation. I made myself a herbal tea today, and the message on the tea bag is, your strength is your own belief. And I think that's a good thing to end on. And I wish you all well. And thanks so much for your participation. We will say goodbye now, but I hope we will continue this conversation. Thanks very much.